Well, good morning again, everyone. Good morning. Thank you. I sort of like a call and response. My name is Andrea Kelton Harris, and I'm part of the diversity team here in FAS, and I'm really honored and pleased to welcome you here this morning to the first diversity dialogue of the fiscal 2017 series. I'm so excited that you're all here to begin a journey with us on intersectionality. By just a show of hands, how many of you have heard anything about intersectionality in the news or in your life lately? Yes. How many of you totally get it? Okay. That's what I thought. You're in good company here. And so intersectionality is our theme for fiscal 2016-17, and it's a way to bring light to the identities of people that may be invisible to the groups that claim them. A lot of words, still don't get it all the time. So for example, girls of color in the fight against the school-to-prison pipeline. When you talk about the school-to-prison pipeline, you typically talk about boys of color. But there are girls of color who are at risk also in that same population. Muslim Americans in mainstream America. You talk about Muslim Americans as being a part of mainstream America, but sometimes their religion is invisible to you because we're all Americans. That's somewhat of what it is, and we're so glad that Dr. Professor Nsiah-Jefferson is here today to help us go through a primer, Intersectionality 101. So you may be asking yourself, why are we doing this? Why is this so important? Well, one thing that I realized as I started looking into this topic is that none of us are one-dimensional. None of us are just a man or just a woman. There are multiple facets to our characteristics and who we are. And we believe that if you learn more about who you are and how you fit into this world and this society and this workplace, it will help us all to build a more inclusive Harvard, a more inclusive FAS, and a more inclusive environment and culture. And so I'll share some more information with you about our speaker in a few moments, but I wanted to take a couple of minutes and talk with you about our series. After today in December, Celine Ibrahim, who is the Muslim chaplain at Tufts University, will lead a dialogue with us on Muslim feminism. And in April of 2017, Eric Alva, who is a Hispanic disabled vet and a gay man, he's going to come and lead a dialogue with us about overcoming obstacles and how he balanced all of these different intersections in his life. So I hope to see all of you at all three of the dialogues and bring someone with you. Try to bring someone with you who maybe hasn't come. Now today we're fortunate, as I said, to have with us Dr. Laurie Nsiah-Jefferson. She's going to provide us a primer on intersectionality. Dr. Jefferson is a senior scientist and lecturer at Brandeis University at the Heller School for Social Policy and Management. Her research interests relate to simultaneous intersections between aspects of social difference and forms of systemic oppression at the micro and macro levels and its impact on various social incomes. She was formerly a policy analyst at the Civil Rights Project at Harvard Law School. Dr. Nsiah-Jefferson earned a joint Ph.D. in social policy with a concentration in health policy, health services, an M.A. in women and gender studies, and a B.A. in African American and Afro-American studies and politics from Brandeis University. And she also holds an M.P.H. in health services administration from Yale University School of Medicine. She's still welcome here. She is a recipient of numerous awards and honors, including a certificate for distinction in teaching from Harvard's Derek Bok Center for Teaching. Frequently called upon to share her expertise, she served on local, national, and international committees and boards. And I know we're in store for a beginning of a wonderful journey, so let's welcome Dr. Nsiah-Jefferson with a hearty round of applause.
I'm not good with mics, Bill. Just tell me if I'm all right. Well, first of all, good morning. It is an absolute pleasure to be here. Am I on the mic?
Yes.
I'm okay. It's an absolute pleasure to be here and be the speaker for the opening session of Diversity Dialogues 2016 on intersectionality. And I will have to say something. I'm from Brandeis University, and I told everyone that I was coming to Harvard to talk about intersectionality. And I said, we're going to have an awful lot of people in the room, and we should try to get this many people in the room at Brandeis. So I already set out a challenge for them. I want to thank Andrea Kelton-Harris, the Human Resources Office, and the team that took time to create and coordinate this series. I am also humbled and excited that such a large group of individuals have an interest in learning more about intersectionality. It is my hope that I can inspire you to learn more about intersectionality, but more importantly, what I want you to be able to do is leave this room today and be able to take something with you to your office, to your community, to your home, something that will help you to move equality along the way. One of the reasons that I do the work I do is because I'm really, really committed, strongly committed to addressing inequalities and inequities in society. And intersectionality is one way to do this. Later on, what we'll do is we'll come together in small groups so that we can process and think about what they heard today. I think it's really, really important that we don't just listen and hear, but we talk about and we dialogue on what we're learning. That's very, very important. So interest in the applications of intersectionality have grown exponentially in popularity over the past 15 years. Scholars across the globe from a variety of disciplines, including sociology, political science, health sciences, nursing, geography, philosophy, as well as feminist studies, queer studies, and legal studies, have drawn from intersectionality to challenge inequities and also to promote social justice. This practice has also extended to policy makers, human rights activists, and community organizers, searching for better approaches for attacking and addressing persistent social issues. It should be underscored that higher education professionals are also enjoying and employing intersectionality as a tool to support excellence and address equity in educational settings. So one of the things that I hope to do today is not just talk about intersectionality broadly, but since most of us here, I'm assuming, are in higher education, and to be able to bring back some tools that you might be able to use in terms of higher education practice, research, and policy making. So again, I saw many of you raising your hands in terms of you've heard about intersectionality, but the question becomes, how much do you know and how much more do you want to know? And so consequently, the overall goal for this presentation is to provide a clear guide to intersectionality. So what I'd like to do, it's going on its own, huh? Maybe I should use the. All right, now I see. I must use this. Keeps it under control. Okay, we're back to normal again. So the goals of this presentation are to define intersectionality, to highlight the categories and schemas of intersectionality, the controversies in the field and the implications for addressing social inequities, the benefits and the applications of intersectionality in the work environment, including interpersonal interactions, policies, and practices. So one of the things that I want to talk about today is intersectionality in higher education. And one thing that we know is that frameworks that categorize students, staff, faculty along singular dimensions of identity provide limited information which can restrict the ability of higher education scholars, institutional members, and leaders to sometimes accurately understand and respond to challenges that exist in post-secondary education. So one of the things I want to do today is I want to tell a story about intersectionality in an institutional research setting. And I'm someone that really enjoys telling stories. As a little girl, my father was a genius in terms of telling stories. He fueled my imagination and creativity with his stories. And ever since, I can't stop telling stories. It's an integral part of how I communicate with others, especially my students. Storytelling is a way to convey a message, to assist us to more easily open up to concepts and frameworks. So my first story relates to an institutional officer at a local university. And that particular officer was approached by a faculty member. The faculty member was really, really perplexed and having a hard time in his class because he had a number of Asian students who were not doing well in the class. Some were even failing and others were dropping out. And he thought that maybe by looking at some data, he would get some information as to what the problem was. So the institutional officer began to look at the data around Asian students. And he came back to the faculty and he told the faculty, well, our Asian students, in fact, are doing better than our other students in terms of their grade point averages, their persistence rates, and their engagement in the classroom, as evidenced by their evaluation reports. And at that point, he gave that information again to the faculty member. The faculty member was perplexed. He said, well, I don't understand because my data in terms of what I'm seeing in the class is not meshing with the data that you're giving me. And come to find out, what was happening was that they were looking at aggregate data in reference to the Asian students at their university, but they were not looking at a subpopulation of Asian students. So the students that were taking the particular class that this particular professor was teaching were primarily first-generation Southeast Asian students. And therefore, the data was not capturing a subset of the Asian population. And so what ended up happening was the professor kind of just went away and said, well, I don't know what's really happening, and really didn't have any tools to move forward. And then I will tell you a second story. The second story was there was a climate survey that was being done on campus. And so there was a lot of interviewing of African-American students, as there were with other groups within the school. And so there was a small cohort of students who were saying, African-American students that were saying they did not have a place within the school. They didn't feel comfortable. They didn't feel as though they really wanted to move forward because they weren't getting their social needs met. And again, the data overall was crunched. And they had some general observations made in reference to African-American students, but the data, again, was not matching the data in reference to what these young people were saying that were a subgroup of the African-American population. And again, what the researchers ended up saying was, this is an outlier. This is an outlier. We don't really know what to do with it. So I'm bringing these stories to, I'm talking about these particular stories because one of the things, as Andrea just mentioned a few minutes ago, subpopulations are really important when we begin to think about intersectionality. Intersectionality is a lot about those population groups, the subpopulation groups. And if we don't know how to gather data and look beneath a larger group, then in many instances we're going to lose not only precious information, but we might lose students, we might lose faculty, we might lose staff. So again, it behooves us to pull back and say, ask the question ahead of time, who are the groups in our school? How should we begin to define those particular groups? And when does the larger category not work? Okay, so the question becomes, what is intersectionality? So one of the things that I'm going to do today is that I'm going to give you a number of different definitions of intersectionality. And that's one thing I learned. At one point when I was beginning to study intersectionality, I said, oh, there's got to be like one standard definition of intersectionality. The problem is there's multiple definitions of intersectionality. And because of that, it can be confusing. But one of the things I want you to pay attention to as I go through the different definitions of intersectionality is to think about what are some of the common elements of these different definitions. And the other thing that I want you to pay attention to is the places where I highlight. Those are the parts of the definition that are key of importance. So one of the things that we know is that intersectionality promotes an understanding of human beings as shaped by the interaction of different social locations. So what's a social location? That can be race, ethnicity, indigeneity, gender, gender expression, class, sexuality, sexual orientation, geography, age, disability, ability, nativity or immigrant status, religion, and it could be many others. That's all I could fit on this particular slide. These interactions occur within a context of connected systems of power, laws, policies, governments, and other political, economic institutions. So, here we see the focus is on the interactions of social locations and how experiences of people are shaped by their interactions with these institutions, given their multiple identities. This shapes their life expectations, experiences, and opportunities. So one of the things that we know is that when we talk about difference, and more specifically inequity, we tend to talk about one form of difference and inequity at a time. That is, we talk about race, racism, and racial inequality. Or, for instance, we talk about gender, sexism, and gender inequality. It is rare, however, that we talk about how these forms of difference exist and shaped, coexist and shape one another. So one of the things I want to bring forth to you is, again, how many of you in the room tend to talk about one type of difference at a time? Just raise your hand. How many people just kind of do that naturally? Okay, so I'm going to ask you another question. If somebody asks you, who are you? Can you describe yourself? How many people use one adjective to describe themselves? Raise your hand. Okay, so what does that tell you? What does that tell you? So there's a discongruence between how you view yourself, but sometimes how you talk about social problems or challenges. We sometimes say, those women, or those people of color, or those, you know, religious group, whatever it might be. Not thinking that in many ways, we're leaving something out. So I'm just going to ask one person in the room, since we have so many, we don't have a lot of time. Who's going to be the brave one to say, tell me how you describe yourself? Somebody raise their hand that wants to describe themselves. Nobody? Who's going to be the, okay, you're the brave person. Can you stand up and tell me how you describe yourself? Well, thank you. No, but I'm really, really glad that you decided to be brave, number one, raise your hand, and tell me a little bit about who you are. Do you see the level of complexity the number of different ways in which this, what's your name? Rima described herself. And one thing I want everyone to hear in this room is that we all have multiple identities. Some people think when we're talking about intersectionality that you have to be a person from a quote-unquote marginalized or minority population. We all have a race, we all have a gender, we all have, you know, a religion or some ideas about a religion in terms of who we are. So again, I just want to make sure that that's something that's really, really clear. Okay, so before I go back to the definitions, I want to say one thing. Intersectionality is a big deal. That's why I'm here, because it's a big deal. Intersectionality theory has been characterized as the most significant intellectual contribution of gender studies in the world. We will explore why this is the case. We will help you to consider the connections to your own work, provide you with new information to better equip you in your role. Intersectionality is complex, but it's something that we can grasp, and it's really, really very important. We can hopefully use our imaginations, our vision, and our contemplation to see these connections. So again, a big deal, complex, but not impossible. I don't know why this keeps happening. I'm sorry. Okay, so another definition of intersectionality is that it challenges traditional ways that knowledge has been produced and provides an alternative model for disciplinary and interdisciplinary intellectual enterprise. It has been applied to policy science, to study political institutions, legal issues, to study discrimination in the workplace, as well as other social problems. And so also we have something called political intersectionality. Political intersectionality refers to how multiple social groups to which individuals belong pursue different political agendas. And you know what this is all about? Have you ever seen a situation where you have a women's advocacy group or you have a racial justice group? And so there's a big agenda for that particular racial justice group or for that women's group or for that gender group. And so what ends up happening is that there are individuals who are actually subpopulations within those groups and in those memberships of those organizations. And sometimes what happens is that those particular individuals' problems and concerns are not at the top of the agenda, or they're not at the agenda on the agenda at all. So political intersectionality is a way in which we know that multiple social groups within a larger group can pursue different political agendas, and what ends up happening is that some agendas fall to the top and others to the bottom. And so that's something that I think is really, really very important for us to think about in our work, in our organizations. You know, do we have an agenda that is actually addressing all individuals in their particular challenges, or are we speaking about and focusing primarily on the agendas that are really sort of what we call top-of-the-line traditional agendas for a gender group, for a sexual orientation group, for a racial group? So another description and definition for intersectionality is that intersectionality is not prescriptive, but rather can be conceptualized as a set of ideas about how to manage and undertake research, provide services, and implement public policy. And what I'm saying here is that when we're thinking about intersectionality, we need to think about intersectionality as not a specific, we need to do one, two, three. Intersectionality is a way in which we bring a perspective to whatever we do. So I'll give you an example. If we're thinking about research, we ask ourselves, so what particular groupings are we going to be studying? If we're studying African Americans, are we studying African Americans only as a large group? Are we studying African American women, African American children? Are we studying African American elders? That was what we need to think about. If we're providing services, who are our services actually for? Again, thinking about, and then also not just who our services are for, but given who our services are for in reference to these subpopulation groups, what does it mean we have to do differently for those different subpopulation groups? Because again, what ends up happening is that we say, okay, we're going to have services for low-income people. Well, can you imagine all the different groups that are under low income? There's a lot of different racial groups. There's a lot of different gender groups. There can be multiple groups under a particular umbrella. And so when we're thinking about serving students that are low income, we're thinking about mentoring faculty that come from traditionally low income backgrounds, we need to dig deeper. So again, what we're saying is that intersectionality provides a critical tool for us to sort of think about multiply marginalized populations. The other thing it's really important for us to think about is that it expands the focus of analysis from merely describing the similarities and differences, but also thinking about how those individual differences also impact on outcomes. That's really, really very important. Because a lot of times we focus on, oh, we have this group and we have this group, but we don't think that much about what the outcomes are in reference to the different groups. So I do a lot of work around health services research. And one of the things that I absolutely know is that when we think about health services research, we need to think about what particular questions are we asking in order to find out more about those outcomes. So for instance, for service provision, it does not tell us what to do, but informs the questions that we ask. Okay. And the questions that we ask about the outcomes are important. So the first thing we might want to know is, who are these different groups? Who are the subpopulation groups? What are the outcomes for this particular group in reference to educational outcomes, GPA, in terms of health services? Do they get the services that they need? And then once we find out what those outcomes are, we can pull back. So that's another way that we can do this work. We can look at outcomes and say, okay, if we're seeing different outcomes, maybe with one group, we're seeing all these different outcomes, we can pull back and say, why are we seeing those outcomes? So when we're thinking about intersectionality not being prescriptive, but providing a way to conceptualize ideas and thoughts, that's one of the things that we're talking about. One of the things that's also important when we think about intersectionality is we think about how it can help us to evaluate the outcomes in reference to services that we provide, whether it be for students, faculty, or staff. So again, if we're beginning to see that there's certain faculty or staff that we have a program, and some groups are doing really well in terms of that program and others are not, we begin to pull back and think a little bit more about that. So the other thing that I want to bring forth in reference to thinking about intersectionality in terms of this definition is that in the current theoretical literature, there are at least four kinds of interactions in reference to intersectionality. There are identities of an individual or set of individuals or a social group. There are also categories of difference. So what we find is that, you know, I can say that I'm African American and I am a woman. Okay, so those are my identities specifically. And then there's categories of difference which are broader than my identity, which is race and gender, religion, geography. And then we have something called the processes of differentiation. And really what that's getting at is the isms. So we have identities, personal identities, we have group identities, and then we also have processes of differentiation, which is racism, sexism, ways in which we find ways to other groups. Then we have something called systems of domination, which is it's colonialism, patriarchy, war, all these kinds of ways in which the world is structured. So we have a structural analysis, and then within that structural analysis, we also think about the ways in which people are othered, And then we also have these categories of difference, which are race and gender and sexuality and so forth. And then we have our own individual identities. So what does intersectionality do? And that's really important for us to ask. Why are we wasting our time thinking about intersectionality? So it moves us beyond single identities or group-specific concerns, which are ineffective in explaining nuances of human lives. It allows us to explore new research, policy, and practice approaches to better understand the connections between structures that shape diverse populations. It also allows us to generate new and complete information to better understand the origins, root causes, and characteristics of social issues. So what I'm saying here, and I don't know if I'm doing this right with the mic here. So what I'm saying here is that it's really important that we're going to generate new information. One of the things that I've done in my research is that I've actually reanalyzed data. So I've had data in which we look at something with very large, broad social categories. Then I was able to take that same data and I was able to analyze it in reference to subpopulation groups. And I can tell you the conclusions of my research were very, very different. So one of the things that's really important is that when we're thinking about research, when we're thinking about data, at the end of the day, depending on the data that we have and what we do with that data is going to really make a difference in terms of the conclusions that we make. Sort of think back to that vignette that I shared with you earlier in terms of the data. And also, what does intersectionality do? It enables more effective and efficient responses than a one-size-fits approach. Again, what I'm saying, and I think I'm saying the same thing over and over again, but in different ways, is that when we think about intersectionality, we're saying one size does not fit all, in that we need to make sure that we have an approach to a problem for a specific set of individuals versus one particular solution or strategy. Because one of the things that we know is that when we have that one solution and we have that one strategy, guess what? There's a big group of people who it's not working for. So if it's not working for that big group of people, then it's ineffective. So one of the things that intersectionality does, it helps us to think about more effective strategies and solutions, which if we want to put a cost on it, it probably means in the long run, it's going to be more efficient and more cost effective. I'm getting paranoid now. So, again, another reason that intersectionality is important is because of the fact that there's a lot of inequity. There's a lot of inequity in the world. 7 out of 10 people in the world today live in countries where inequality and inequity has increased over the past 3 decades. And one of the things we know that inequity is undermining social stability and threatening security on the global scale. And so again, one of the things that we know is that we have been trying to address inequities and inequality for quite some time. And this is, intersectionality is another way to do this. And as I move forward, I'm going to speak about the tenets and the principles of intersectionality. And one of the things that we're going to talk about when we talk about the tenets is the fact that there is a very social justice orientation to intersectionality. And again, so when we're thinking about inequality and we're thinking about ways to address inequality, we want to make sure that we're using a framework that does address injustice in the world. And again, if we know that 7 out of 10 people in the world live in countries where there's inequality, and if we go to the United States, there's pockets all over the place where there's inequality, then we know that we need to try something new and something different. So also, one of the things that I want to spend some time talking about is intersectionality in higher education. And I want to give you the big picture. There's some really good reasons why we need to be thinking about intersectionality in higher education. And I'm sure many of you are doing that already, because you wouldn't be here if some of you weren't trying some of this out. So one of the things that we know is that utilizing intersectionality frameworks can help us more accurately reflect the diversity within higher education in the classroom and in the workplace. So data that simply disaggregates college faculty, students, and staff by gender, race, again, does not reflect the actual diversity that exists in the school. And there's a number of reasons to do this. You know, one reason is that, you know, we want to know what's going on. But sometimes, one of the things Andrea talked about was invisible diversity. And a lot of times when we talk about diversity, we're always thinking about race and gender and social class. There's so many other ways in which we're diverse. There's religion, there's ability, there's disability. There's so many ways in which learning styles. And so one of the things that it's important for us to think about is how do we capture the full diversity within our institutions? And that's not to say, well, okay, we can say we're diverse in all those ways and sort of forget about the racial, ethnic diversity, say, because we've got it covered other ways. That's not what I'm suggesting at all. But what I am saying is that we need to be able to capture that. And so racial backgrounds and sexual orientation influence the experiences of female faculty, we know. Socioeconomic origins and citizenship status can have profound influences on students of color. For instance, we know this. And racial categories include mixed race individuals. And how often do we make sure that we're thinking about the concerns of mixed race individuals? In mixed race individuals can identify with 2, 3, or 4 racial and ethnic categories. If institutional workers and leaders are to maximize understanding of our students, faculty, and staff, they must explore the experiences of these students. So again, it's not just about counting in terms of, you know, we have these intersectional categories. That's important. But what's even more important is that we spend the time to understand the experiences. You know, I'm a researcher, so I think about qualitative and quantitative research, right? Qualitative research is important. And one of the things that I'm going to mention further on in the presentation is that when we do intersectionality research, the ideal way to do intersectionality-based research is to use mixed methods. We want to be able to think about not just the level and extent of a problem, but the why of a particular problem. That's really, really very important. So again, being able to think about people in situations in multiple dimensions, because if we just count widgets, we're not going to know what to do. We're going to know there's a problem, and we're going to know that we need to do something about it, but we're not going to know what to do. Okay, so the other piece is that if we have an over-reliance on one-dimensional categories also becomes a problem so let me put it this way. So one of the things that I find that happens on college campuses a lot, and I've been on college campuses probably most of my professional career, so I'm going to talk negatively a little bit. I'm not about Harvard. I've only been there for a little bit. I'm going to talk about other institutions I've been at. So one of the things that I've noticed is that schools are now really making sure that the voices of different population groups are being expressed. So we will have clubs and organizations for different groups. However, as we give space and voice to these different racial minority groups, it's really important that we also provide adequate space for the subgroups. And I do know at Harvard, I taught at Harvard for 3 years, and one of the things I do know, and actually it's really interesting because the course that I taught at Harvard was actually on intersectionality in the African American community. It was actually one of the first courses that I taught. And it was an incredible, incredible group of students. And I can tell you something, they came to my class and we had the best of time. And I asked them, why are you in this class? And they said, because this is one of the places that I can go and I can be both an African American and I can be those other things that I want to be, and I can also have some intellectual inquiry around it. So again, there was a hunger for those voices. Now, I also know that those students were involved in organizations at Harvard that did allow them to have those multiple voices. But it doesn't happen everywhere, and it needs to happen more of that. The other thing that I think is really important as we're thinking about why we need to also not only address big categories is because big categories in many ways perpetuate stereotyping, right? So if we say, oh, Asian students, or we say African-American students, or we say Middle Eastern faculty, whatever we say, we're putting this sort of big, broad brush around who these people are, right? And again, that's not serving anyone well if we have sort of this big category. So again, it means that we need to drill down and think about that a little bit more. So it helps us to avoid simultaneous advancement and perpetuation of inequities. Okay, so, All right, so we have something called the intersectionality wheel. And I think maybe this should have been my first slide, because this particular slide shows very clearly how we think about the multiple dimensions that we must think about when we think about intersectionality. So as you can see, we have circumstances of power and privilege and identity at the center, which is really, really very, very important that we have that. And this particular diagram was put together by the Canadian Research Institute for the Advancement of Women. And so if we look at the innermost circle, it represents a person's unique circumstances. So again, are you at the center of power or privilege or identity? So again, what is your identity? Where are you in terms of power relationships? And where are you in reference to privilege? And I know that's a really, really hard question to ask people. People don't want to think about having power. People don't want to think about having privilege. It makes us uncomfortable, particularly if we have a liberal mindset. I'm just going to be real with you for a minute. It's hard. But one of the things that it's important for us to do is to be able to sit with ourselves and truly ask ourselves, where is our power and where is our privilege? But also at the same time, ask yourself, where are we also oppressed? Because I can probably guarantee that most of you in this room are going to have identities that are both identities that relate to privilege and identities that relate to oppression. And I really want to make that really, really clear from the beginning. So that's important to be able to sort of think about your unique characteristics. The second circle from the inside represents aspects of identity. And so what we have in here is education, and occupation, and social status, and work history. Do you see how broad that is? You probably can't read it. But it's not just about race, and it's not just about age and class and gender. Those things we talk about all the time. It's about life experience, geographic location, refugee status, religion. All of these things are part of who we are in terms of our identity. And then we see the circle from the inside represents different types of ways in which people are othered, ways in which people are oppressed. So we have ableism, we have racism, we have discrimination, we have heterosexism, we have classism, we have all of these things, transphobia, ethnocentrism. But one of the things that's important for us to think about is, how does all that happen? Where does it all sort of come from? If we look at the outermost ring here, it represents larger forces and structures that work together to reinforce these systems. So if we didn't have colonialization and we didn't have globalization, we probably would not be in the boat that we are in. So we have to sort of look at this on multiple dimensions. That's really, really very, very important. Okay, so I'm not gonna talk about all these images, but one of the things that's important is that we have other representations of intersectionality. So we have a traffic metaphor, we have the Grand Canyon, we have a marble cake. Now, I don't know if anybody's hungry right now, it's a little early, but you might be, and we also have the kaleidoscope. So I'm going to talk about the traffic metaphor. That was the classic early metaphor that Kimberly Crenshaw came up with to depict intersectionality. So again, we can see the traffic metaphor on the right-hand side. It depicts intersecting roads of oppression. This image was one of the original models, as I mentioned before. And so what we see is we look at the different ways that are going into the road. We would say one road goes is race, another is gender, another might be social class, another one might be religion. And one of the things that this particular model says is that you have all of these cars coming in on these different roads, and they're going to crash, and they're going to have something called an intersectional accident. And so that is what that particular model was about, to sort of say when you put all these things together in one person, and especially if you do it in reference to marginalized status around race, around gender, around social class or religion, you are going to have trouble in many ways. However, I will have to say that this particular image is now out of fashion. I still like the image by virtue of the fact that it allows us to kind of easily see. But I'm going to ask somebody, does anybody, seeing what you know about intersectionality and what you might have heard today, does anybody have any critiques about this model? Can you see why, could you see another model that might be better? I'll give you another model in a minute, but I just thought maybe you might have some ideas. So I'm going to give you one clue. Okay, good. I don't even have to give a clue. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right. That is, and that's one problem. Another problem is, if you look at it, everybody's going in the same direction. And sometimes you're not always going in the same direction. Sometimes your identities can get messy. And sometimes you actually have two identities in one place, in one person, which is not captured in this way. So one of the things that people have suggested is that we have other types of images. One image is the Grand Canyon. And the point of the Grand Canyon primarily is to sort of say that there are many, many things that influence a formation, many things that actually make a difference in terms of how a person experiences themselves. So the Grand Canyon spends time, and one of the things that it talks about is that instead of streets, rivers have flowed in such a way as to craft the Grand Canyon, one of the most majestic natural wonders of the world. In addition, the river still flows therein, but not as it did 1,000 years ago. The intersectionality canyon includes both the dynamic, time-oriented aspects embodied by the rivers that run through it and the institutional rock formations that change slowly based on the river's flow. So really what this is saying in a nutshell is that this metaphor addresses how intersectionality addresses how identities are fluid and can change over time. Have you ever been to another country and your identity is not the same as it is here in terms of how you are described? Has that happened to anyone? Has anybody gone to Brazil? Has anybody gone to South Africa? And all of a sudden you are no longer an African American, or you're no longer an Asian. Has that happened to anybody here? Okay. That's a really good point. And the other thing that also happens is anybody also changed their identity over time or thought about themselves differently in 1960 than they did in 1982 versus 2006. So one of the things we're talking about is fluidity, and that it's really important when we think about intersectionality that we're thinking about time dynamics, and we're thinking about the fact that we're not always the same all the time. And also what's important to think about when we're thinking about that particular image is that our identities are also contextual. So depending on where you are has everything to do with the experience in which you're having. And I'll give you an example. If I go to my black church on Sunday morning, I'm not thinking about race because everybody around me, or almost everybody around me, is a black person. Now, if I go to the business meeting and everybody in the room is primarily male, then I might start thinking, okay, I'm a woman. So it really makes a difference because at one point in time, you might feel like, I'm cool, I'm here. And so race has very little salience, or gender has very little salience, or religion has very little salience, or social class has little salience. But if you go in a situation where you're the only one or one of the few, then that salience is going to rise very exponentially. Very, very important. The other image that I want to think about is the cake image. And one of the things that's important when we think about the cake image is that when we blend our baking ingredients together, like we bake our different experiences together and the different identities that we have, we're going to come up with something that is not just those ingredients. All of a sudden, you don't even see, when you make a cake and it's cooked, do you see the egg anymore? Do you see the flour anymore? No, you don't. So what happens when we bring all this together, we create something new. And one of the things that's really important when we think about intersectionality is that we don't think about additive identities. We don't think, okay, I'm black. In my case, I'm black, and then I'm a woman, and then underneath a woman, I'm a Baptist. That's not sort of how it goes. What we create is a different experience when we put all of that together. Because my brother and I are not going to sound the same because he is a male. And also he works at Boston College, so we're never going to be the same, right? And I'm at Brandeis. So we joke about that all the time. But again, we create something new. And that's what's important when we think about intersectionality, is that we're creating something new. It's not the same. I'm going to talk a little bit about, I'm not quite sure why this is doing it. I'm going to talk about a little bit about the principles of intersectionality. So some of the principles that we have in reference to intersectionality is social justice and equity. We've talked about that before. We talked about intersecting categories, multi-level analysis, power, reflexivity, time and space, and diverse knowledges. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but I'm going to talk about a few of them. So we've talked a little bit about time and space, but I'm going to talk about it a little bit differently for a moment. How we experience and understand time and space depends on when, where we live, and how we interact. And so it is within these dimensions of time and space that different types of knowledge are situated. And what I mean by that is that we all have different constructions of the world. We all have different constructions about what is knowledge and what even passes as a legitimate knowledge. So one of the things that intersectionality does is that we really think about how we understand time and space and knowledge, because that's different depending on who we are. And being able to say time and space is not the same for all of us. And then also getting to connect with that is the diversities of knowledge. So intersectionality is concerned with, again, who can create the power, who has the power to create knowledge and knowledge production. And one of the things that's really important when we think about intersectionality is that we want to make sure that the knowledges that we keep in our toolkit are not just the knowledges that we are familiar with and that we accept. So when we're thinking about understanding faculty and students and staff, we need to look at and respect the knowledge that they bring to a particular process or the knowledge that they bring to solving a problem. And I know that can be particularly difficult for academics in an academic environment because we really hold strongly to academic rigor and what we define as academic rigor. So again, that's really, really very important. I'm not going to spend any more time on that because I'm going to talk about the tenets, which gets into some of this. Okay, so again, we know tenet one, human lives cannot be explained by taking into account single categories. Lived realities are shaped by different factors. And again, when we think about the different factors, we're not just talking about our identities, we're talking about our identities and how they relate to the social structures and institutions that we interface with every day. So I come in as an African-American woman to my institution at Brandeis, and how I engage in that institution and how that institution engages with me is going to color my experience. So again, it's not just about the identity, it's about the identity as it pushes up against social structures and institutions. All right, so I'm just going to wrap this up anyway. And mention a couple of other important tenets. One is this tenet of privilege and oppression that I mentioned earlier. And again, I put up Oprah Winfrey. Now, can you guess why I put up Oprah Winfrey in terms of thinking about privilege and oppression? What kind of privilege does Oprah Winfrey have? Yeah, she's got money. So I'm going to tell you a really interesting story, and some of you might have read this in the news. But so Oprah Winfrey is not going to be the same as a low-income employed male living in New York City in the middle of Harlem. That's not her experience, right? But sad to say, or not sad to say, Oprah Winfrey is still black. And you might say, well, what do I mean about the fact that she's still black? Well, did anybody hear about the story a few years ago when I think she was in Scandinavia somewhere? It might have been Switzerland. I'm not sure exactly where she was. But she went to a very high-end boutique. And, you know, she was looking around. And the particular shopkeeper basically made an assumption about who she was. And made an assumption that she did not have the money that she would need to purchase anything in that shop. So again, one of the things that we know is that we both have both privileging as well as oppressing identities. And one thing that we know, we think about, Henry Louis Gates? You remember that story, right? And it's really interesting because one of the books that Charles Ogletree wrote, he talked about, he collected experiences of African-American, highly professional men who had been stopped by the police in more than once in many instances. So again, you might be able to have privilege in certain ways, but if you're sort of out there and no one knows who you are and they just see your face, or they just, you know, see what you're wearing and make assumptions about who you are, then we need to recognize that. So there are intersections of privilege and oppression, but it only goes but so far. The other thing that's really important that I mention, and when we think about intersectionality, again, is power dynamics, but also making sure that when we think about intersectionality, we're thinking about the different levels that we interact with every day. So again, I mentioned this a few minutes ago, I interact as an individual with people. So I can have an experience that's upsetting, it's discriminatory, it might be something that's troubling to me in terms of interaction that I have with a coworker, with a friend, with an acquaintance. That's one level of ways in which we interact with each other when we think about intersectionality. The other way that we think about, so we could be thinking about the different identities clashing in an interpersonal perspective, but we can also think about intersectionality in terms of, again, how we connect, an individual connects with an institution. That's really, really very important. So institutional level as well as individual level. So whenever we think about intersectionality, we should hope to be thinking about how these two come together. And if you think about it from a statistical perspective, we're talking about multi-level analysis. So for those of you in the room who likes to crunch numbers, think about multi-level analysis, how we need to put in variables both for the institutional variables, the institutional variables and the individual level variables, and then think about what that outcome is when we put those two sets of variables together. All right, so what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna pretty much, actually it stopped exactly where I wanted to stop, no joke, this is really incredible. All right, so this is, and I'm not even joking, this is like really, this is what I was trying to say. When we think about intersectionality, if you don't get anything else, get this slide. And so when we think about intersectionality, there are a number of approaches. There's a unitary approach, the multiple approach, and then there's the intersectional approach. And the reason that this particular slide is so very important is because sometimes we get the multiple approach mixed up with the intersectional approach. So the unitary approach says we have one category and we have one approach. And then we have, and there's no relationship because it's only one category. So we're thinking about race, or we're thinking about gender. And we're thinking about it either at an individual level or an institutional level, but we're not thinking about it at both levels. And then when we think about the multiple approach, we are thinking about, say, race and gender. So we're moving along, right? But again, when we think about this, the categories are first determined. And this is something I didn't bring up before. So we decide this is what race looks like, and we decide this is what gender looks like. But again, remember we talked about validity? Gender and race can look different to different people, and we have to define that. But when we do it this way, with race and gender, we have a predetermined way in which it looks, and it's static, and it's not movable. And again, we're only looking at it at one level, the institutional or the individual. And the category is uniform. But if we go to the, and so what's really important is we don't think about the relationship between race and gender, we're just analyzing data in reference to both of those things, but we're not thinking about the relationship between the two. When we go to the intersectional, we're looking at more than one, so it could be race, gender, class, whatever, but we're looking at, first of all, a relationship between the two, but we're also saying that the relationship can be a relationship that we can define and we can determine. And we also want to look at the relationship between the individual and the institutional factors, and we also want to think about, you know, how these factors impact on individuals in multiple different ways. Okay, so I'm going to leave you with that, and I'm going to just ask you, how much time do we have? Are we sort of, because I wanted to try to do the 15 minutes. Okay. So what I want to do right now, and I might need some help in terms of bringing up the set of questions that I have for the audience. So one of the things I'm going to ask you to do, I could talk about intersectionality all day long, as you can see, but I wanted you to be able to get a sense of that intersectionality is about power dynamics. It's about moving equity forward. It's about making sure that we don't just look at broad categories in terms of social location, but that we look at categories, we look at subcategories within, so that people's voices and their experiences are not lost. So what I wanted to do at this point was I wanted to highlight some questions, but I don't see the person to kind of, maybe I can see how we get this up here. Yeah, I just need to, like, I want to pull up the questions that I want to ask the audience. It's on here. Yeah. So. Yeah, well, it's on the PowerPoint, but it's on the other. I have one more.
Switch on another.
Yeah, it's just like another. So maybe just escape this. Oh, yeah, okay. Should escape it. Yeah, there it is.
You got it? No, it's not up.
Well, while they're getting that up, I'm going to, hopefully I can give you an idea of what we're going to talk about. So I'm going to give you a choice of two questions you can answer. And I just want you to pair up with somebody that is close to you, unless you just want to run to your best friend, and that would be fine too. So one question is, and this is a bigger holistic question, what are some challenges in your workplace or other experiences that you would like to apply an intersectionality frame of analysis? So think about where you work, the types of programs, the students, the faculty that you serve, or whatever you do, and what are some of the challenges in your workplace that you would like to apply an intersectionality frame to it, and say why. I don't know why that didn't come up. Because the other one's much more, the other one's more detailed.
This is what you want to show?
Yeah, that's the one I wanted to show. Okay. All right. Okay, guys, hello. So you have a choice of two questions. One was the one that I just brought up. There's another one that's a little bit, it sounds like it would take a long time, but it doesn't at all. And I'm going to read it out so you can make a decision between the two. I want you, this exercise is a lot of fun. I want you to write down your different identities. Share your list with your partner. And then ask your partner what identities on their list are considered privileged identities versus oppressed identities. And do these privileging and oppressive categories change depending on where you are? Also, one of the things you can think about is what order did you write down your identities and sort of talk about whether there was any significance in reference to the order that you wrote about. You want me to speak louder? You want to make it bigger? Oh, gosh. Bottom right. I am like the worst person when it comes to technology. You're going to help me? I am not good at technology at all. You can make it bigger?
Yeah. Is that better?
Yeah, that's fine.
Is that better?
Is that better? Okay.
Now I just have to move it up.
Yeah, that's okay. You don't have to have the whole thing. There's more questions enough. All right. So again, which identities are privileging? And also, did you have a difficult time writing up a list? So those are some of the questions that I have. So just decide which question you want to use, and then share it with your partner. Okay. 10 minutes. Hi, everyone. I decided I'd come down from the big stage and just have a conversation with you. So how was the exercise? And make sure you use the mic when you want to talk about what you did in your small group of two. So who wants to, let's start with the first question about addressing a challenge in your workplace or other venue that could utilize an intersectionality frame. So how many people answered that question? Just a few of you? So that wasn't a popular question, right? But could you go to the mic, and if anybody go to the mic and share?
Sam's going to bring the mic.
She's going to bring it around.
Raise your hand.
Can you come and talk about a little bit of your conversation?
You have a hand over here.
Okay, how about you over here?
Okay.
Over here with the orange.
So we were talking about the students we serve, and right now, thinking about first-generation students and low-income students who have different intersecting identities. But we actually kind of finished talking about like wealthy students of color and some of the alienation that they feel on campus, because that's an intersection that doesn't often get talked about.
Wonderful point. So did you come up with any ideas about the challenges?
I mean, I work with undergraduates quite a bit, and I was just talking about conversations I've had with students and some of the research they've done on these points and how sometimes it's misinterpreted by other people in the department. And I don't think we really came up with solutions. We were just kind of exploring the diversifying faculty, which is, I know, an ongoing struggle. Yeah, so that's the first step, diversifying the faculty and the departments.
Well, I really enjoy the fact that you did think about these subpopulation groups. And it's really interesting because with African-American populations, it wasn't until recently that people began to think about social class and not being just low income. It's always been sort of, when we think about African-American populations, we think about low income people. It's sort of just the frame that we use. And so it's important to think about other population groups and what might be some of the things in which students need. And one of the things that's important to think about is not just formalized programs and services, but also other ways that you can support students in terms of even self-care and the things that they can do to make things better for themselves. And I think diversifying faculty is something that we're all sort of at the top of the food chain in terms of academic challenges that we face. Anybody else?
We talked about staff and, you know, staff conflicts and how to unpack some of those things, that it's not, you know, just what the it's not just situational, but it often comes with layers of where people come from. The fact that we're at Harvard, you know, being in an academic department where faculty have more power than staff, and also the role of self-reflection, it being able to think about, you know, what you bring to the table when you start to engage in these, you know, these conversations, and how we could bring some of this back to staff.
What I really like that you talked about was self-reflection, and again, that is one of the tenets of intersectionality, because we can't do the work unless we know. Which can in many ways actually cloud the situation. And those hierarchies in some ways are silent, and in some ways they're extremely loud. Does that make any sense to you, that it can go both ways? Because I think we try to act like they're not always there, but there is this undercurrent. And one of the things in terms of staff that I think are really important is to think about this whole piece of who in a staff actually feels privileged, even though you might be in equal positions. And that privilege might come from where you grew up, it might come from your race, it might come from your socioeconomic background. So sometimes we'll have staff that are in equal roles in terms of their titles, but they have different backgrounds, and sometimes that brings clashes in reference to perspectives, in terms of expectations, in terms of how they expect to be treated. So you bring all that with you, and then you have to complicate it all, of course, with, you know, your work responsibilities, which will cause stress for anybody, right? All right, maybe one more in reference to thinking about challenges and intersectionality. Would you like to, can you have the microphone? And I like your pink, though.
I'm coming from a different space, data science and data analytics, so I kind of approach it differently, analytics.
Oh, analytics,
data.
Okay.
So one of the things why I came here was I'm actually doing some study around improving engagement, and one of the data points that we're looking at is around ethnicity or inclusion. So, but my gut tells me that we're looking at it one-dimensionally. And I mean, I think what you showed, the grid was very powerful to me. I just probably need to understand it a bit more. And the whole idea is that if I have better cuts and data is another, I was gonna ask you, the collection of data is obviously voluntary. I think the better we are in capturing all those intersection points, the better we are in crafting the right messaging, the right programs to position people to be more successful, and that on top of that, probably improve engagement. So, for alumni. Yeah.
And I think you're absolutely right on. And one of the things I didn't really spend a lot of time talking about was the quality of data that we have now. So one of the challenges is that most of the data that's being collected is collected in a way in which it's aggregated by big categories. And sometimes that data is being dictated to be gathered in a certain way because it's what the federal government says or what some entity says you have to do. So the question then becomes the time and the resources in order to gather new data so that we can get those particular intersections. And we don't always have those resources available. So part of what I'd like you all in this room to become are advocates. And what I mean by that is to say, we need to collect data this way from now on. And then sometimes, believe it or not, data is collected in smaller, granular ways, but it's reported in a larger group way. And so sometimes we can actually go back and get data and disaggregate it even further. But that's something we have to ask. But most of the time, it's not always there. And that means that we might have to get grants to do larger studies and big studies to get what we need. And sometimes that might be doing some smaller work. But one thing I will say is that, you know, getting the big money and getting the permission to do X, Y, and Z, sometimes takes an awful long time. So we can do smaller studies, and we can talk to people. We can begin by talking to people and finding out what their experiences are and capturing that and respecting their voices. Yes.
I've always come from a perspective, and this is arguable and debatable in my own personal kind of belief, right? That for me in 2016, diversity is not an issue for me personally, mm-hmm. right? For me, the issue is creating places of inclusion where
yes.
people can, and sustained inclusion.
Yes.
And so
yes.
you talked about individuals connecting with an institution, and you mm-hmm. talked about that happening via this kind of multi-level analysis. And so my question is, how can we do that? How do we create, and I'm sure that we do it on, you know, multi-levels with faculty and with mm-hmm. staff and showing kind of spaces of inclusion and spaces of diversity within making these spaces more diverse. But I just wonder, what's the thing that can connect our students with the institution?
Yeah. And I think the first thing you have to do, and this might sound a little bit like what is inclusion, right? Because one of the things I have been working, one of the things I also do diversity consulting, inclusion consulting along with everything else, and what I find is when I go into many organizations, they have not really defined what inclusion is. What they do is that they bring the definition that's in the textbook. But in your institution, you have to decide what it means to you in your institution and what it means to different groups. Because what I find is that some people equate inclusion with diversity, which clearly is not the same thing, right? And then in addition, what others do is say, well, it means people feel welcome. Well, what does welcome mean? People are working to their, given opportunities to work to their full capacity. How do we know what their full capacity is, and what do we do about that? So I'm going to start with that in terms of how we even defining inclusion. But second of all, what's really important is to ask the individuals themselves, how do you feel excluded? Because the opposite of inclusion is excluded. And when you are included, how do you and why did you feel included in this particular entity, whether it's a classroom, whether it's a club? Find that out and then say, this is what we're going to have to do in terms of developing our programs and our services. These particular components need to be in there. And we need to also operationalize those particular components. What does it mean for a student to feel safe? What does it mean for a student to be able to take the initiative, or the faculty or the staff to take the initiative, to be able to say something and feel like what they're saying makes a difference? How do we understand that that faculty or that student or that staff felt heard? So that's really how I would think about it, is having us listen to anybody and everybody that needs to be included. And I think that's everybody, regardless of who you are, but also pay attention to people who have been marginalized in many instances traditionally.
I just have this thought, and how much I appreciate the dynamic framework that is in the presentation. And I think in the workplace that we are in from on a day-to-day basis, I think what oftentimes comes down to is how we work with one another and preserve that individual dignity. And so when the individual dignity is threatened, either from just a casual, assigning tasks, or just interaction and how you respond to questions, or just every day, from 9 to 5 when we walk into the office, this daily interaction, and we have high touch customer service kind of a day-to-day responsibilities. The framework gives us a very tangible way of looking at how to address these issues when it comes up. Without the framework, you kind of have to grasp for every tools that you have, to address why someone is feeling being unfairly treated. Mm-hmm. And so I just want to express my appreciation for the framework.
Well, thank you. And one of the things that I think it's important that you've suggested is also issues around both, microaggressions in the work environment, micro insults within the work environment, as well as, how those particular types of experiences are, how they're experienced by others, but also we need to think about how does that happen. And my whole thing is I always have to look at the institution, and I always feel like the institution has a connection to when things happen on an individual level around microaggressions. Because I love talking about microaggressions, but what I always say to people when we think about microaggressions is that it happens within an institutional structure. And that means that as an institution, we set the tone, we set the pace, we set the policies. It doesn't mean policies are going to solve everything. We know that they don't. But that is the responsibility of an institution to be able to do that. And I think one of the things you're talking about is, when you feel trauma in the workplace, or when you feel uneasy in a workplace, we have to begin to ask ourselves, what happened, but also why did it happen? What were the roots of that happening? One of the things that I'm really, really keen on is for us to think about the roots of something happening, because if we can't get to the root of the problem, then we never really solve it. Because what we end up doing is that we put a Band-Aid on it to be torn off, and next week we have the same problem again. So maybe what I'd like to do now, and again, thank you for those really wonderful insights. I'd like to maybe go on to, if we have a couple of minutes, to go on to the question about your identities and pairing up with a partner. So one of the things, just to remind me, we ask people to write down their different identities, share their lists with their partner, ask about whether the identities are privileging or whether some of those identities relate to oppression, and does it change over time? So does anybody want to volunteer? Because I think it can be a really interesting conversation. And also, one question was, did anybody have trouble writing their list?
Hi, everybody. I'm Janai. We talked about our identities, and one of the identities that we all identified with was being female. and we discussed how being female can be a privileged role as well as an oppressive identity as well. We talked about how being cisgendered actually as a female is empowering, well, not empowering, but it's one of our privileges that we have, that we experience. And then how in workplaces or different situations we can be oppressed by that. And then we also discussed the intersectionality with our education and how being highly educated and also having master's degree, how that interacts with how we get treated in the workplace and how that shifted at places we've worked. So I brought up how working here changed my view of myself because I actually have a master's degree, but everybody in my department has PhDs, so sometimes I don't always feel like I don't feel as comfortable as I probably should in my skin, but talking about those different sectionalities really opened my eyes to seeing like things that I probably don't always recognize.
So you were able to unearth some things. And I think, did everybody sort of agree in your group? Was anybody sort of a dissenting voice? I like to start trouble.
I think we actually built off each other when speaking about being female and woman in this day and age. We're thinking how we, Janai and, sorry, and Jen were speaking of how they don't feel that as oppressive in general, and it's readily recognizable as an identity. I, however, generally see myself accepted and I feel comfortable being myself as woman, but have had occasions where I've seen it as, I've seen the biases against me being a woman. So that's one example. So I think we built on each other in the conversation.
And that's really an important thing to be able to learn and grow from each other. And I think, again, what I'm taking from the conversation that you had was that it is contextual. You know, what you are experiencing or not experiencing is contextual. And that if you went into another environment, if all of a sudden you went to Wall Street, I have students that I worked taught that were, you know, MBA students. And some of the things that the, you know, females would tell me about what was going on when they did their internships was just, you know, somewhere out of this world. So again, I think it's important to understand if it's going relatively well and relatively comfortable, what are the factors that are making that happen? And if it's not, what are the factors that are making that happen? Because again, that gets to problem solving and identification. Anybody else? Thank you.
So we talked about a lot of different factors of identity, but one that I think I want to talk about because I don't think it gets talked about a lot is within race. I am a mixed race individual that's also white passing. And so I have this unique experience that I think is really uncommon where I'm mistaken for being white all the time and can be around white colleagues or white friends even and witness and overhear and be asked to engage in conversations that are really oppressive. To a part of my identity and a part of my community. So that's something that I just wanted to bring up and hear other people's thoughts on too, if anyone wants to share an experience, because I think it's really uncommon and never talked about in my experience.
Well, one of the things, and thank you so much for sharing that, that's really important. And one of the things that I will bring up is something that happened to me that's, you know, it's not the same thing at all, but it's related. Has anybody heard the term of sort of being like the acceptable black person, the acceptable woman, or the acceptable whatever, right? And like I used to have friends who used to tell me, oh, you're the golden girl. Like everybody, you know, likes you, whatever it might be. But I remember people would kind of, quote unquote, forget I was black sometimes. You know, I don't know. At that point, I had locks, so I don't know how the heck they, you know, did that. But the thing about it was they would say things to me like, you know, you're not like the others, or, you know, this person is really, really, you know, negative. And they would tell me about other people of color that were my friends and thought it was all right because they were, quote unquote, all right with me. And I find that to be, so what I've learned is when that happens to me, I make it really clear that it's unacceptable and I am not going to participate with them in terms of denigrating people that I identify with, and also make it very clear to them that what they're doing is biased and in some instances plain racist. Anybody else? Okay.
There's also another perspective too, being a person of first generation within the Black community, experiences are much different. So then when we are amongst other individuals who are not first generation and to have that conversation, and there's a disconnect there. Mm. You know, so that's another part of identity that's very interesting too.
And thank you for sharing that. And I think that social class and it's something that we don't spend a lot. We don't want to talk about social class unless it's like in a social policy class or something. We don't want to talk about it. I mean, we'll talk about race till the cows come home now. We'll talk about gender till the cows come home. But we don't want to talk about SES for some reason. And I think part of the reason has to do with the fact that we have this quote-unquote American ethos that we all can get to a certain point if we just work hard enough. And the problem with that, it's not true. Simple and straight. Yes, we can all work hard. And I think that we don't ever want to bust that. So because we don't want to bust that, what we do is that we just pretend everybody's the same. But I can tell you, I've been in classroom situations where people have said some things that are really, really offensive about different socioeconomic groups, and not even necessarily realize what they're saying. So I think also getting back to that is, you know, how do we address the issue within subpopulation groups that, you know, people can be just as offensive if you're a higher income person and you're talking about a group that's not as high income, you can be just as offensive as a cross-racial kind of conversation. And recognizing that those kinds of things are just as damaging as a cross-racial discussion, which could be biased. Yep. Okay.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Chelsea, for bringing that point up, because I happen to be Latino, and in when people find that I'm Latino, sometimes they feel comfortable saying things that are oppressive about the white culture. But what they don't know is that I'm married to a white woman and my kids are mixed. Mm. So I'm like, well, just, you know, this is something that I care about and that I obviously identify with by marriage and now with kids. So it's easy to also fall on the trap of bashing the dominant culture and being part of that compromise of having a biracial marriage is saying, hey, there's a give and take, and there's good things and bad things about both.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
Thank you for that.
I think that's an excellent point, in that, you know, we are a society now that is becoming more and more multi. In fact, I was sort of at holiday time, we have the United Nations in my house now because of, you know, we have interracial marriages and so forth. And again, how do we negotiate the growing multiracial society that we have? How do we think about it? And what does that mean for our interactions with our children, with our relatives, with our friends? And everyone has a different way in which they think about their racial status. But again, it's something that we really need to think about, particularly when we're thinking about intersectionality. It kind of sort of just makes sense given the theories and the paradigms around intersectionality. So I think that this is the last question, right? That was the last question, correct? Well, you know, thank you all so much. I really had a wonderful, wonderful time, and I hope that you learned something in reference to what I presented today.
Hi, folks. Good morning, good afternoon. My name is Chris Ciotti, and I'm Associate Dean for FASHR. So Dr. Laurie Nsiah-Jefferson, thank you so much for being with us today. Another round of applause. I think what you did today is you opened up a conversation that you know, we all very much appreciated and want to have and need to have, and it was informative and it was fascinating. So thank you very much for that. These dialogues are an important part of our diversity efforts at FASHR, or actually at FAS. And as I look around the room and I see all the faces and everybody sitting here, we're really grateful that you've chosen to spend this time with us today. We realize how busy you are and how many other places you can be, and that you take time out of your day to come and to step into the unfamiliar and to learn together is really what Harvard is all about, and we very much appreciate that, and we don't lose sight of it anytime. We're also able to stand here today and bring this kind of programming to the FAS and the Harvard community because of the continuous support and generous funding of Mike Smith and Leslie Kerwin, and we don't forget that either. A big thank you, always, to the FAS diversity team, to the volunteers from my own FASHR team. These dialogues wouldn't happen without your efforts, so thanks, guys, very much. And always a special thank you goes to Andrea Kelton-Harris, who spearheads the Diversity Dialogue series with a passion and an energy and a purpose that makes it really special. So thank you, Andrea. We have two books today for the Diversity Spotlight. One is Why Are All the Black Kids Sitting Together in the Cafeteria and Other Conversations About Race? Supposedly very, very informative, very thought-provoking. I think you really like it. It's by Beverly Daniel Tatum. And we also have a book that we've spotlighted before with our summer speaker called Balls, You Have to Have Some to Get Some. And that's by Chris Edwards, who was our dialogue speaker this summer. I've read that book. It's wonderful. So I highly recommend that second book, having read it, about the transgender experience from his point of view. We've also, to end on a wonderfully delightful note, chosen 12 of you to receive a copy. We chose at random of one of these books, and your names are posted outside on the registration desk. So check it out. It could be your lucky day here. Our next dialogue is on December 6th. So put that into your calendars, and the topic is a fascinating one, Muslim feminism, not an oxymoron. And Chaplain Celine Ibrahim from Tufts will be our speaker, and we hope you'll join us. One thing I wanted to mention with Laurie is I think you can add to your intersectionality your facileness at dealing with slides, which were coming and going without your intentionality. So whether you're African-American, woman, certain age, add that to your piece, because that's not an easy thing to do. So last but not least, as Andrea mentioned before, we're continuing our rally challenge. And I mean, remind you of that again. If you register for each dialogue, if you attend each dialogue, you listen and you learn during the year-long Diversity Dialogue series, you're going to be entered into a drawing for either an Apple or a Samsung smartwatch. We've given away three of these already, so continue to come. As Andrea said, bring somebody, and we'll all learn together. So thank you from the bottom of our hearts for making time today to come. We'll see you in December, and go in peace. Thanks.